morning, friends. Let's continue with this area, which is we were started with valuation of security or security analysis. In that, one area is done, which is your rights issue and share buyback. So today we will start with something called as valuation of shares. There are multiple valuation models which are there. This is in page 36 of your workbook. Come to page 36 of your workbook. Page 36 of the workbook. Now, whatever valuation models we are going to see, these are only an illustrative list. I cannot have an exhaustive list because a company can do valuation under different modes. To give an example, if I have to value Tata Consultancy Services vis-a-vis Infosys Limited, vis-a-vis Wipro, if I have to do a comparison and I have to do a valuation of them, I may also do a valuation on the basis of number of employees into revenue per employee. That is, I will set something called as an industry-wide what should be the revenue per employee or what should be the value per employee. So whichever company has more employees, that will have a better value as compared to a company which has lesser employees. So you can do valuation under different modes. So it can be based on the number of employees in case of an IT company. So different industries, you may use different parameters. What we are going to see is commonly used valuation models as far as shares are concerned. Now the commonly used ones are, the first one which you know, Gordon's model or perpetual growth model. Gordon's model is basically P naught is equal to D1 by KE minus G. In that case, D1 refers to the distant dividend. You may have to take an assumption on that if it's not very clear. Sometimes D1 may not be clear, so we take an assumption on that, divided by cost of equity minus growth rate. How do you calculate growth rate? Everything we have seen earlier, IRR into retention ratio. Cost of equity, something which is investor's expectation, or something which is called as opportunity cost of capital or cost of equity. The second one is Walters model, again which we are aware of. What we do in Walters model, D by KE plus R by KE into E minus D divided by KE. So D by KE is one part of the calculation, R by KE into E minus D divided by KE is the second part of the problem. So that is the next model which we may use. Now I will discuss more on these. Step up growth model, price earning multiple model and free cash flow approach model. Now I will first explain step up growth model. Now, what the question will say is that your Gordon's model says that the price of a share is equal to D1 divided by KE minus G, and the G has to be a single G. So the question will say year 1 to 4, the company will grow at the rate of 10%. Year 5 to 8, the company will grow at the rate of 6%. Then year 9 onwards, the growth will stabilize at 4%. This is what the problem says. So first 4 years you will grow at the rate of 10%. Year 5, 6, 7, 8 the growth will be 6%. Year 9 onwards the growth is going to stabilize at the rate of 4%. This is the growth pattern of the company. Now when I use Gordon's model, which is P naught equal to D1 by KE minus G, when you use this formula, you don't know what growth to use. Should you use 10%? Should you use 6%? Should you use 4%? This is the problem you will face when there are multiple growth patterns in a company. So the company may not grow always at a constant rate. The growth can be varied. So whenever the growth is varied, you don't know what formula to use, because your denominator KE minus G, that G is can be 10%, can be 6%, can be 4%. And the Gordon's model says you cannot use this formula until the growth is constant. So you have to tell me a consistent growth. So the model can help me in only doing this. P8 is equal to D9 by KE minus G. Why P8 is after 8th year the growth is going to stabilize. So you can find out the price at the end of 8th year if you want. For that the growth will be 4%. P8 is equal to
D9 by KE minus G. For that purpose, the growth will be taken as 4%, because growth has stabilized at the rate of 4%. But before that, if I have to use the formula, I cannot use it. So what step up growth model says is that, our varied growth model or multiple growth model says, you will have to calculate something called as year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. Year 1, I'll write the dividend. Year 2, dividend. Year 3, dividend. It goes on like this. Till year 8, I'm going to write the dividend. At the end of year 8, I can value the share. I'll write the market price. At the end of year 8, I can do the valuation of a share as per Gordon's model only if the growth stabilizes. If the growth has not stabilized, you cannot use this formula. So you will have to wait till the growth stabilizes. In this case, the growth is going to stabilize after 8 years. So I'll have to wait till 8 years. I cannot use the formula. So what we will do is, year 4, 5, 6, 7, every year you will write the dividends, and at the end of year 8, you will write the market price, because you can value it. You discount these cash flows at the investor's required rate of return, you get the current market price. I can get the current market price of any security, be it a debenture, fixed deposit, share, preference shares, equity shares, anything, with just 4 information: year, cash flow, PVF. These 3 is what I need. You tell me what is the cash flow structure, what is the your expectation, we will discount it and get the price. So I need the year and cash flow and the discount rate which you want to use. Combine these 3, you get the price, or you get the discounted cash flow. Put a total of the discounted cash flow, that will give you the current market price. Clear? Any doubts on this? Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. So this model says, this stage refers to a scenario where growth happens in multiple stages. Though I talk about 3 stages, practically there can be 10 stages also, 15 stages also, it doesn't matter. The only thing I need is, growth has to stabilize. The moment growth stabilizes, I will start using the formula I want to do. If the growth has stabilized, till the growth stabilizes, I can't do anything. The moment growth stabilizes, growth may stabilize even in the 80th year. P80 is equal to D81 by KE minus G. Whenever the growth stabilizes, let the growth stabilize, use the formula, get the price, before that have the dividends, discount this and get the current market price. So calculate dividends till the end of the second stage, market price at the end of second stage using Gordon's formula, discount the above cash flows to get current market price. Discount the above cash flows to get current market price. Next is price earning multiple approach. I need not explain much to you. Price earning multiple approach is, your price is equal to EPS into P multiple. EPS into P multiple. I'll come to the last one, which is free cash flow approach. Now, when it comes to free cash flow approach, we will start with EPS as the starting point. So let's take EPS as 100 for a company. EPS is 100 for the company. Now, ideally, EPS is something which can be distributed to my shareholders in the form of dividends if I don't have any requirement of money. If there is no requirement for the money, ideally, I can give this to my shareholder. Now, what free cash flow approach says is that, start with EPS, don't do anything directly with the EPS. After EPS, you calculate something called as capex and working capital requirement. Capex and working capital requirement. Any company will have 2 types of requirements. One, they'll need money for working capital purpose. Working capital is when you keep growing, your debtors will increase, your inventory will increase, the amount of cash which you maintain have to increase, because all of this depends on the amount of sales you are doing. So one, you need money for capital expenditure, and second, you need money for working capital. Now my capex and working capital requirement can be 150 rupees. My capex and working capital requirement can be 150 rupees. Now I need 150 rupees for this purpose. This will come for 2 sources: equity and debt. Equity guys will put in money and debt guys will put in money. So what we will write here is, amount raised as debt, amount raised as equity. they will have a ratio saying that 60, 40, 50, 50, 40, 50, 40, 60, whatever. Let's take it as 40, 60. So debt guys will bring in 60 rupees. Equity guys will bring in 90 rupees. This is what the company is going to do. Now what we do is EPS less money required for capex and working capital. 90 rupees gone there. Money required for capex and working capital. 90 gone there. The balance is called as free cash flow slash dividends. Free cash flow slash dividends. The model says whatever surplus money which is left over is technically a money which you can distribute to your shareholders. Is technically the money which you can distribute to your shareholders. There's no point in keeping the free cash flow with you. So at the end, we calculate something called as free cash flow. And the formula which we use here is P naught is equal to FCF 1 divided by KE minus G. Like D1 by KE minus G, it's called as FCF 1, free cash flow of year 1. The logic for this calculation is FCF 1 is like dividend 1. FCF 1 is like dividend 1 because you are going to distribute this. What are you going to do with free cash flow? You are going to give it to your shareholders. There's no point in keeping the free cash flow along with you. So you will take it and say to the shareholders, take the money, I don't need it. Clear? Done? Now apart from this, can there be other models? Yes, when I do the problem, I may end up using any other model. So it is not that I have an exhaustive list of models to be used. You can have any other type of evaluation model. So that we'll see with the problem. There can be assumptions based on which solutions can undergo change, because assumptions also play a bigger part in our solutions. Let's start with topic 25. A company has a book value per share of 137.8. Return on equity is 15%. Follows a policy of retaining 60% of its earnings. Opportunity cost of capital is 18%. What is the price of share today? Okay, now coming to this question, so the heading says it what model to be used, but how do I approach a problem is, let's keep those five models in mind, that is your Gordon's model, Walter's model, P multiple approach, free cash flow approach and step up growth model. Now which model to use? Step up growth model will talk about multiple stages of growth. If multiple stages of growth is not talked about in the question, let's ignore step up growth model. P multiple needs to be given in the question if at all P multiple approach is to be used. So these two are very clear. Step up growth, when do I use? If multiple stages of growth is given. They say 10% growth, 15% growth, 8% growth, 20% growth. If P multiple is there in the question, we may use earnings multiple approach. Now then I am left with only three approaches: Walters, Gordon's and free cash flow. For free cash flow approach, the question will somewhere make a reference of capital expenditure and working capital. Somewhere there will be a reference with respect to capital expenditure and working capital, saying that we are going to do so much capital expenditure or there is so much of working capital requirement. Then left with Walters and Gordon's. When it comes to Walters, you need dividend, you need earnings. So I need D, I need E and I need KE. D, E and KE is the requirement for Walter's model. Gordon's model needs more or less, Gordon's model I need D, KE and growth. So if growth is possible to calculate, we go with Gordon's approach. Growth is possible to calculate, we go with Gordon's approach. In the same problem, if E and D, that is EPS and dividend, both are available. EPS and dividends both are available in a question, then we end up using Walter's model. Then we end up, perpetual growth is technically called as Gordon's model, your perpetual growth. So if you look at this question, I have book value of 137.8, ROE is 15%. Book value into ROE is EPS. Book value into ROE is technically your earnings per share. From the earnings per share, I have a policy of retaining 60% of its earnings. So I will get dividend per share. From the earnings, I will get dividend per share. So E is possible, D is possible. Opportunity cost of capital is what? K. So K is also possible. And if I want for Gordon's approach, I also can calculate growth rate. Growth is IRR into retention ratio or ROE. Now write valuation of share. Valuation of share. Valuation of share. Valuation of share as per Walter's model. Valuation of share as per Walter's model. Share as per Walter's model. Basic data, below that basic data. Basic data. Dividend, sorry, earnings equal to, earnings equal to, earnings equal to book value into ROE. Book value into ROE, earnings equal to book value into ROE. What is the book value? 137.80 into 15%. Earnings is 20.67. Then dividend equal to earnings into payout ratio, earnings into payout ratio, earnings into payout ratio. into your retention is given, so balance is payout, so 40%. 20.67 into 40%, 8. Okay, so rounded off to 8.267 or 8.27. So 8.27 is what your dividend is. So I need dividend, I need earnings, we need KE. This is as far as Walter's model is concerned. For Gordon only we need the growth rate. Next, KE. What is the opportunity cost of capital? So KE is 18%. KE is 18%. R, return on equity, 15%. So KE is 18% and R is 15%. 18 and 15%. Now let's apply it in the formula. Write the formula. P naught equal to D by KE. D by KE plus R by KE into E minus D. R by KE into E minus D divided by KE. d by ke plus r by ke into e minus d divided by ke. Dividend is 8.27. KE is 18%. R is 0.15 divided by 0.18 into 20.67 minus 8.27. 20.67 minus 8.27. You can get a little bit of a different answer because of rounding off, if at all you are getting different. The final answer will be broadly equal to 103.35. That's the final answer, 103.35. D by KE plus R by KE into E minus D divided by KE. That's what Walter's model says. D by KE plus D is dividend which you are paying, which is 8.27. R is the rate of return on equity, which is 0.18. K is cost of equity into earnings minus dividend, 20.67 minus 8.27 divided by 18%. Any doubts on this? Now the same thing we are going to value under Gordon's model. If a problem has information on P multiple, you will do under P multiple also. If the problem has information on free cash flow, you will do under free cash flow. You may get 5 different answers to a same question. So whatever is applicable, you will have to end up doing valuation as per all the possible models. So next, valuation as per Gordon model, and both will mostly give a different answer only. Valuation as per Gordon's model. Valuation as per Gordon's model. Now, when we do Gordon's approach, we end up writing or we end up using mostly the same thing which we use in Walters, except an additional item called as growth. So I'll first calculate growth and then I go to the formula. So growth is equal to what's the formula? IRR into retention ratio. IRR are basically ROE, whatever it is. IRR into retention ratio. IRR into retention ratio, 15% into 60%. IRR is 15%, retention is 60%, growth will happen at the rate of 9%. Growth will happen at the rate of 9%. Now, listen for a minute. The only part is what to take as D1, whether to take 8.27 as a dividend, which is going to be paid in the next 3-4 months, called as D0, or it's going to take something like a 7-8 month period, or a next year, that's called as a distant dividend. So that will not be very clear whether that 8.27 which you have calculated is going to be paid immediately, or it's going to be paid after a year. There you will have to take your assumption. It is assumed that 8.27 is distant dividend in bracket D1. It is assumed that 8.27 is nearby dividend in bracket D0. This assumption is something which you would have taken at IPCC level also. When we do cost of equity calculation there, the formula used to be K is equal to D1 by P0 plus growth rate. In that, sometimes we will take it as D0, sometimes we will take it as D1. We used to write a note. So I'll write a note. Our assumption is that 8.27 is D1 for this question. You can also take it as D0, it's your wish. So now, right, it is assumed that dividends of 8.27, it is assumed that dividends of 8.27, dividends of 8.27 is distant dividend. 8.27 is distant dividend in bracket D1. We don't have this problem when I do Walter's approach. There it's only D, there's no constant of D1 or D0. P0 is equal to D1 by KE minus growth rate. P0 is equal to D1 divided by KE minus growth rate. Now, Walters have given a fair price of some 103. Gordon's has given a fair price of 91.89. Any doubts on this? You can get multiple answers depending on the different models. Any doubts? Can you proceed? Clear? No. Assumption. You can take it as D0 also. So, the alternate answer to this is 8.27 into 1.09. So 8.27 is D0 with a growth of 9%. This will become 9.01 next year dividend. 8.27 plus 9% growth. So that's your assumption. If you take this assumption, your answer will change as 100.16. So I don't have a straight answer saying that you'll have to assume this way, because there's no consistency and the problems are not consistent. It's the issue with the problem, not even institute's answer, because the problem is not very clear, so you can't do anything with it. See, the basic concept is it's a perpetuity. When the growth is happening, it's a growing perpetuity. Perpetuity is always valued a year in advance. So if dividend is going to be paid in year zero, I cannot value with that dividend in the current year. I need the next year dividend. So to do a perpetuity valuation, you always need the next year cash flow rather than the current year cash flow. So that is why I need D1 and not D0. Clear? Let's move to the next question. Go through question number 2. Okay, they have given dividend of the company. Growth has been given in the question. Some risk-free rate, market return, and company has a beta factor of 1.5. Now, whenever beta is given, You could have got introduced to this formula, but I'll be doing extensively in portfolio chapter. There used to be one formula for KE called as RF plus beta into RM minus RF, technically called as capital asset pricing model. There's a separate chapter itself on that. So there I'll be analyzing it. So whenever beta is given, with the help of beta, I can calculate something called as KE. So you can always calculate KE with the help of beta. So in a practical world, if somebody wants to value the shares of Infosys Limited, now when you want to value the shares of Infosys Limited, you have decided that you will value it under Walters model or Gordon's model. If I have to do Walters model, I need earnings, which the Infosys balance sheet will give you. You need dividend, which also again the Infosys balance sheet will give you. Earnings will come from Infosys P&L, dividend will come from Infosys P&L. You want, the next thing which you want is R and KE. R is return on equity, again you use the formula, you get it. But KE is a very tricky part. KE is basically cost of equity, investor's expectation. You say 10%, somebody else says 12%, somebody else says 14%, somebody else says 16%. In that case, a model came called as capital asset pricing model. This capital asset pricing model can be used to value all capital assets. Now, for a capital asset pricing model, the starting point is called as beta. Beta measures the volatility of returns of a security. If you ask somebody, they'll say Sensex is risky, fixed deposit is less risky. Sensex is considered to be risky, FD is considered to be less risky, equity is considered to be risky, your debentures are considered to be less risky. Now, the reason for the riskiness is they're not worried that the returns may become negative, the returns may become positive. My worry is because it turns out to be negative, positive, there's a huge volatility in my returns. When there's a huge volatility in returns, I become little scared because I cannot depend on equity as a source of income. Equity is like a business. Fixed deposit is like a job. In a job, every month you will get a fixed amount of salary. Whatever happens to the business of the company you work in, you are going to get a fixed amount of salaries. So that is called as stability is there. In a business, that stability will not be there. Sometimes you will have an up moment, sometimes you will have a down moment. So when I go to Infosys, I'll go to Infosys stock market returns. Last 20 years, I'll find what returns they have generated. The moment you find the last 20 years return, with that you can calculate standard deviation of returns you want. You can calculate beta of returns. All of how to calculate standard deviation, how to calculate beta, you have a separate chapter on that. So you will learn all of that. So if somebody wants to do a valuation, yes, you can do it. If somebody wants to know what is cost of equity, CAPM is the best model to get the cost of equity. The formula for them is KE is equal to RF plus beta into RM minus RF. RM minus RF. Listen for some time, don't write it. Anyway, you're going to learn in detail this formula later on. Beta basically measures the riskiness of a security. Beta of a government security is zero. Beta of a government security is zero because it is considered to be zero risk. Beta of a fixed deposit will be closer to zero. Though you cannot say it to be zero risk because a bank may even go bust. So a corporation bank may not exist in the after 5 years. So there is some risk associated with fixed deposit, some risk associated with FD of lot of companies. So if Reliance Industries Limited is issuing a fixed deposit, it is considered to be little lesser risk because you know Reliance may exist for another 20 years, a company which has a strong balance sheet, whereas an unknown company, XYZ Limited, when it issues fixed deposit, that is considered to be little higher risk. See, you know the concept of KE, you also know the concept of beta, you also know the concept of riskiness. Lot of people in practical world employ that. When I say you employ that, I tell you that you have to give a loan to ABC Limited. You have to give a loan to State Bank of India. What is loan to State Bank of India? Creating a FD in State Bank of India. SBI says 7% rate of interest, you are happy giving them. An unknown person comes and says, can you give me money at the rate of 7%? You start worrying. Why do I give at 7%? Can't you give me 14%? Can't you give me 18%? Because you yourself think there is a risk associated with it. Because of the risk associated with it, you say you want a higher return. Now what this model says is KE. Now RF government security is 7. Government security is 7%. Zero risk. There is zero risk associated with 1. RM refers to market return, technically called a Sensex return. Technically called a Sensex or Nifty, which is 12 minus 7. If you have a beta of 0, you need only 7% return. The formula will say 7 plus 0 into 12 minus 7. If you have a beta of 0.5, what will be the answer? 7 plus 0.5 into 12 minus 7? 9.5. You further increase the beta to 0.8. You further increase the return to 11. You keep increasing the return as beta increases. If beta increases to 1, you need a 12. It increases to 1.5, you need a further increase in return. So basic thing is, you have something called as a risk-free security, which has zero risk. There is no risk associated with the risk-free security. There's a market which has a beta of 1. You can either be riskier than the market or less riskier than the market. If you are more riskier than the market, give a return more than the market. If you are less riskier than the market, give a return lesser than the market. That's the concept. So if beta is available in a question, with the help of beta, you can easily calculate something called as KE. Clear? Any doubts till now? So wherever beta is available, anyway, I'll discuss in detail in capital asset pricing model. There we'll also understand how to calculate beta itself. Practically, if at all you are interested in valuation of a security, you want to practically apply, you need all of this information. When I did problem number 1, you got all this information directly. In a practical world, none of the information is going to come directly to you. You'll have to do a lot of research to get to all of this information. So one easy way of getting KE is through beta route. Easy way of getting KE is through beta route. If you don't want to use that, then my valuation will be for different set of people differently, because you will say 10%, somebody else will say 15%, somebody else will say 18%, somebody is going to say 14%. If I have to do an overall valuation for everybody and alike valuation, then it's through beta. So the beta is going to increase from 1.5 to 1.75. If beta increases, risk increases. If risk increases, KE is going to increase. And when KE increases, price will come down. When KE increases, price is going to come down. That's the relationship. Wherever risk increases, you end up reducing the price. Wherever risk increases, you end up reducing the price. That's how our minds work. Whenever there is an increase in risk, I reduce the price which I want to pay for the return which is going to generate from that security. Now, this company pays a dividend of 2, growth of 7. I have dividend, I have growth, I have KE. Can I use Walters model? Walters model. Growth is given, no? No, Walter. Last problem also we use Walters, no? Growth was there in the last question. Can we use Walters? I'm asking you. For Walters, I need earnings, which is not available in the question. I need return on equity, which is also not available in the question. I'm just trying to tell you, how will you think in an exam scenario? Because exam scenario, that heading will not be there saying that this model is to be used. Because that is where the struggle will come in. So Walters is not possible, because for Walters I need earnings, I need return on equity. Both of them are not available in the question. Can we use Gordon's model? Think about it and tell me, can we use Gordon's model? For Gordon's, what do you need? D1 is needed, available. K is needed, can be calculated. So K is available, it can be calculated. Growth is available, yes. So I can use Gordon's model in this question. Gordon's is possible. I'll come to the detail analysis. Gordon's is possible. For Gordon's, you need dividend, you need cost of equity, you need growth rate. Even if growth rate was missing in this question, I would have used Gordon's model with the growth of 0%. Even if the growth rate was missing in this question, we would have used Gordon's model with the growth rate of 0%. It's not necessary that growth rate has to be there. Growth can also be 0%. P multiple can't be done. EPS into P multiple, that's not possible. free cash flow is not possible, multiple stages of growth is not there. So the only model which can be used in this question is Gordon's. Clear? Any doubts on this? The last problem we used Walters as well as Gordon's. In this problem we can use Gordon's model. Valuation as per Gordon's approach. Valuation as per Gordon's approach. Valuation as per Gordon's approach. Below that, existing KE. Existing KE. We have to get two answers. They have said find out the present as well as the likely value after the decision. So what is today's value? And I'm taking some decision because of that, what is going to happen? So existing KE, RF plus beta into RM minus RF.
This is how you have to write beta. This is the symbol. Beta symbol is this. So your beta will be written like this. KE, sorry, RF plus beta into RM minus RF. RF plus beta into RM minus RF. What is the RF? I am doing the existing KE, 9 plus beta 1.5. RM is 13% minus 9% plus 1.5 into 13% minus 9%. The existing KE is 15%. Existing KE is 15%. Then do revised KE. Revised KE. Your beta increases to 1.75. You are basically increasing the risk of the business. You have increased the beta to 1.75. Beta has increased to 1.75. Accordingly, KE increases to 16%. Clear? Any doubts on this? Done. Now let's start. Existing price. Existing price. D1 by KE minus D. D1 by KE minus D. Company pays a dividend of 2 per share, so technically can be D0. On that I apply a growth of 7%. See, this D0, D1, still the confusion will be there. Pays a dividend, are they going to pay it in shorter period or is going to take a longer period of time? That confusion will always be there. So I take it as D0 for this question. Whatever note you take, please, whatever assumption you take, no assumption, there's no assumption. There's no logic behind why D0, why D1. Mostly, whatever assumption I am taking, maybe I know the institute answer and accordingly I am telling you what institute would have done it. But there is no logic behind why D0 or why D1. So there is no logic. You write a note and then proceed with it. Ideally, they shouldn't deduct marks because the student has written an assumption. So because I don't have a consistency. If there was a consistency saying that every time they are taking D1, then I can at least tell you that. So that consistency is not there. So because of that, let's write whatever assumption, whatever we are taking. So now write, it is assumed that dividend of 2 is D0. It is assumed that dividend of 2 is D0.
dividend of 2 is D0. Now existing price, what is the growth rate they have said? So 2.14, 2 plus a 7% growth on that, 2.14, 15% minus 7%, 2.14, 15% minus 7%. So the present price is 26.75, and this is going to change because of the decision we have taken. Whenever KE increases, price will come down because risk has increased in the business. The risk has increased in the business. Any doubts on the existing price? They have said find out the present as well as the likely value, then likely price. Likely price. Denominator alone changes. Existing is 26.75. And the likely price is 23.78. Cost of equity has undergone a change. Because of that, price will undergo a change. So from 26.75, it has dropped to 23.78. No, that's no specific D0 or D1 you're saying, no? There's nothing like that. So it because it's 50-50, more or less institute has taken sometimes this way, sometimes the other way. Any doubts on this? Clear? Let's proceed to the next question then. X Limited is a shoes manufacturing company. It is all equity finance and has paid up capital of 10 lakh. X Limited has hired Swastika Consultants to analyze the future earnings. The report state as follows. Earnings and dividends will grow at 25%. Earnings are likely to grow at the rate of 10%. Further, if there is a reduction in earnings growth, dividend payout ratio will increase to 50%. Other data are as follows. You may assume that the tax rate is 30%, not expected to change in future. And post-tax cost of capital is 15%. By using the dividend valuation model, calculate expected market price P ratio. Please go through the question. Okay, now coming to this question, they have mentioned in the question that earnings and dividend will grow at the rate of 25% for the next 2 years. Then they are going to stabilize at the rate of 10% from third year onwards. So the growth is going to stabilize at 10% from third year onwards.
So technically they are asking us to use step-up growth model. Wherever multiple stages of growth are there, we will have to end up using only step-up growth model. So for step-up growth model, I follow three steps. In step one, I calculate dividends till the growth stabilizes. So here, the initial theory said the growth happens in three stages, but this problem, the growth is going to happen only in two stages. In stage one, it's for 2 years at the rate of 25%, and then at the rate of 10%. I'll just come in a minute. Now, so the dividends are going to grow at the rate of 25% for the first 2 years, and then the growth will happen at 10%. So I'll have to calculate D1, D2 as well as D3. Why D3 is required is to calculate price at the end of year 2. P2 is equal to D3 divided by KE minus G. So the basic calculation which we do is, I calculate the dividends till the end of the year the growth stabilizes, and the price at the end of that year, So let's start working note one. Calculation of dividends till year 3. Now please listen. Ideally what I will do is take the dividend of last year and apply the growth on it. Year 1, what is the growth? 25%. So what we will ideally do is 3.84 plus 25%. Take that number, another plus 25% for the next year. Third year, what is the growth? 10%. So we will apply 10% on the D2. But that's not going to work out in this question. The reason for that is, further if there is a reduction in earnings growth, dividend payout ratio will increase to what? 50%. So as of now, if you see, the payout ratio is in the calculator 2.52 divided by 6.30. 2.52 divided by 6.30. How much? 40%. 3.84 divided by 9.6. They have been consistently doing a 40% payout. When the payout changes, the growth is going to be significant in that year. It's not going to be a 10% growth. It can be a significantly higher growth. Listen for some time, I'll tell you to write. So what we are going to do is year EPS and DPS. I'll also write EPS along with dividend per share. Year 1, 2, 3. Year 1, 9.6. into 1.25, growth of 25% on the earnings per share. 9.6 into 1.25, again into 1.25. third year, the growth is going to be 10% into 1.1.
when it comes to dividend, 3.84 into 1.25 into 1.25, but this year you cannot do into 1.1. If you do into 1.1, you will get only 6.6. But what is going to happen is into 0.5. I'll change my payout as 50%, and the growth indirectly in that year is something like 37.5%. The dividend growth for year 3 is 37.5%. This is not going to matter from a problem solving point of view, but I need that 8.25. Growth doesn't change to 37.5. I'll explain later on why growth doesn't change to 37.5, but year 3 dividend can't be taken as year 2 dividend plus 10%. You cannot take it as year 2 dividend plus 10%. Clear? Any doubts on this? It's going to be year 3 EPS into 50%. Year 3 EPS into 50%. Clear? Any doubts on this? Anybody has any doubts on this? Any doubts on this? I'll explain the importance of this later on when I do a problem solving further, when I come to valuation part. Any doubts on this calculation? So when they say earnings are likely to grow at the rate of 10%, the normal assumption is dividends will also grow at the rate of 10%. I don't need the question to tell me that earnings and dividend are going to grow at the rate of 10%. The question has clearly mentioned that if there is a reduction, dividend payout will increase. If that line, third line, was missing in the question, mostly we will do 6 into 1.1. They need not tell me that dividends will grow at the rate of 10%. I don't need that information in the question. Now, what happens is when you solve a problem in a hurry, people read it as 25% growth and 10% growth, you end up directly applying it on the dividends. If you do it that way, you're going to get an incorrect answer. That's the only thing which I wanted to say. Now complete this, then later on the importance of this you'll understand. First complete till this. Your third year dividend is EPS of year 3 into 50% rather than second year DPS plus 10%. Okay, now listen for some time. Any doubts till now? Any doubts on the calculation? Listen for some time. Now let's look at some other information which is given in the question. You may assume that the tax rate is 30% and post-tax cost of capital is 15%. What is the use of these two information? Tax rate 30%, post-tax cost of capital 15%. Use of this information, tax rate 30%, post-tax cost of capital is 15%. Yeah, whatever comes to your mind, what is the use of this information? Where do I subtract it? What is tax rate of 30% and post-tax cost of capital is 15%? What is the use of this? Or is this an irrelevant information to the question? K is... No, K is how much you said? No, so... Do I need to use this information somewhere or can I ignore it? Okay, KE will be. Okay, okay. So, one, the concept of capital budgeting says that you need to be consistent in your calculation. So, if your cash flows are post tax, the discount rate should also be post tax. If the cash flows are pre tax, the discount rate should also be pre tax. Now, when I value a security, dividends are considered to be tax exempt. Capital gain is something which I cannot calculate. So, whatever I normally calculate as year and cash flow, that is always post tax. Now, the only information, only use of this is, instead of giving post tax of capital, sometimes they'll say pre-tax cost of capital. Then it would have become 15 into 1 minus tax rate is the cost of equity. 15 into 1 minus tax rate. The tax rate 30% is an irrelevant information to the given question. Tax rate of 30% is an irrelevant information. Post tax cost of capital is a relevant information, which is KE. The cost of equity for this question is 15%. Any doubts on this? Any doubts? Okay, now listen for some time. Again, I don't want you to write. I'm going to do the valuation. There I'll be doing certain extra adjustments. PVF at 15%, DCF, year cash flow, PVF at 15% and DCF. Now, I'm just writing 4, 5 and 6. I'm not going to use this in the question, but I'm just writing it. I'll prove certain information with this. Now, year 1, year 2. In year 1, the company is going to get dividend. Year 2, you will get dividend. At the end of year 2, P2 is equal to D3 divided by KE minus G. P2 is equal to D3 divided by KE minus G. What is D3? 8.25. KE 15% minus growth rate of 10%. 15% minus growth rate of 10%. This is what the prices are expected to be. In year 1, you will have a dividend of 4.8. Year 2, you will have a dividend of 6 rupees. And at the end of year 2, the share price will be 165 rupees. The share price will be 165 rupees. That's what the model at least says. Now, your discount rate is 1 divided by 1.15. Again, divided by 1.15. You would have learned all of this at IPCC level. Your discount rates. The price according to the model is 133 rupees. As of now, it's 133 rupees. Now, your perpetuity has been arranged in such a way that the valuation which we did know, P2, I can even do it as P3 is equal to D4 by KE minus G. P4 is equal to D5 by KE minus G. It does not matter in which year you do the valuation. You can do any year the valuation the moment growth stabilizes. and in all ways the answer is going to remain same whenever you do the valuation. Now that is what I want to show. So somebody says he is going to value it only at the end of year 3, then in year 1 he will get 4.8 dividend, year 2 6 rupees dividend, year 3 8.25 dividend, year 4 is, sorry, your valuation is D4 divided by KE minus G. The price is going to be 181.5. It does not matter when you do the valuation, whether you do it in the value in the 3rd year, 4th year, 5th year. Why I am showing this is, lot of people get a confusion that when it's a perpetuity, why do you want to value an year in advance? Why can't I value at the end of 3rd year with the help of 4th year cash flow? At the end of 4th year with the 5th year cash flow? You want to do anything, you do it. Answer is going to remain same. That's how the model has been arranged. The formula has been derived in such a way that you do the value at the end of year 2, you do the value at the end of year 3, you do the value at the end of year 4, you do the value at the end of year 5, it doesn't matter. And the growth rate can be taken as 37.5. From year 2 till year 3, the growth is indirectly 37.5 for dividend, because dividends from 6 rupees increases to 8.25. The model says what is the constant growth. So whatever is the constant growth, find that and then do the discounting. Any doubts on this? Any doubts on this? Next, come down, valuation of share. Valuation of share. Valuation of share. Now below that, first write few points. Point number one. Dividend valuation model can be used to get the market price, once the growth stabilizes. Next point, the growth is going to stabilize from year 3 onwards, is going to stabilize from year 3 onwards, and hence from year 3 onwards and hence P2 from year 3 onwards and hence P2 can be calculated and hence P2 can be calculated P2 can be calculated using Gordon's model. P2 can be calculated using Gordon's model. P2 can be calculated using Gordon's model. P2 equal to D3 divided by KE minus growth rate. P2 equal to D3 divided by KE minus growth rate. Can I do P3 value and calculate? Yes, you can do anything. You want to do P3, you do it. You want to do P4, you do it. Any year you can value. So P2 is equal to D3 divided by KE minus growth rate. Next, P2 equal to, you know the D3, 8.25 divided by 15 minus 10, you get it as 165. 8.25 divided by 15% minus 10%, you get it as 165. Any doubts till now? Next point. The post-tax cost of capital is given in the question, and hence tax rate is an irrelevant information. and hence tax rate is an irrelevant information. Tax rate is an irrelevant information. Stop. If pre-tax rate is given in the question, if pre-tax rate is given in the question, same can be converted into post-tax. Can be converted into post tax using the below formula. Post tax KE. Post tax KE equal to pre tax KE into 1 minus tax rate. We are not required to do any of this in this question because anyway they have directly given us. Now do this valuation, complete this year cash flow, PVF, DCF. There's nothing to copy from the board, you do it on own and then check it. The price is expected as 133.47. Any doubts on the price? Clear? Can we proceed? Okay, now the second thing they've asked is P ratio. By using dividend valuation model, calculate expected market price and P ratio. Now whatever price I have calculated, I'm going to use that price and calculate P ratio. What is the EPS of the latest year gone by? EPS of the latest year? 9.6, whatever the question has given. So listen for a minute. EPS 9.6, P multiple. Based on this, I'll get the P multiple. As of now, this should be the P multiple for the company. 13.90. What we have been used to doing is, with EPS and P multiple, we used to get the market price. In this question, with market price and EPS, we are getting the P multiple. This should be the P multiple for the company as far as our model is concerned. Our model says it has to be 13.90. Now, please listen. In an institute problem, you will have a lot of scope for assumptions. Multiple different answers can be there. I can also understand maybe they are asking this P multiple. The price is anyway given in the question, 93 divided by 9.6. You can have different possible answers to a question. It can be 93 divided by 9.6. I can also argue saying that it can be based on the forward earnings. Practically, it's mostly on the forward earnings. So you can have multiple different answers to a question. There are always scope for assumptions to an institute solution. So that, if you take it properly, it's okay. This will comprise at least 15-20 marks of your entire 100 papers. Because of assumptions, answer undergoing a change, nobody can do anything with it. So today I tell you the answer is 133.47 divided by 9.6, 13.90. Institute may do the same thing in your practice manual, but comes in exam, they may end up doing 93 divided by 9.6. So these are things which are beyond control, which you will continue to have in this paper. You will continue to have assumption based answers changing. According to me, logical one is, this is the market price they have calculated. Based on the market price, they are asking us to get the P multiple. So get the P multiple and complete it. P multiple is equal to expected price divided by EPS. Okay. Any doubts on this? So there's something called as, when you read a research report of any of anybody releases a research report, they'll say the forward earning P multiple is, or 1 year forward P multiple is so much, 2 year forward P multiple is so much. So if you use 12 rupees, that's technically 1 year forward P multiple. If you use 15 rupees, that's 2 year forward P multiple. The next year earnings you are using to get the P multiple. I am just using the latest year earnings. Whatever is the latest year earnings for the company, that is being used to get the answer. Can I use forward EPS and do it? Yes, you can do it. There's nothing wrong in doing that. You can end up using 1 year forward multiple or 2 year forward multiple. The answer will be a little different. No, so the market price is today's price. So this is like what we have done in this problem is, P multiple is a balancing figure. Your P multiple is kind of a balancing figure. Now, next year the EPS is 12. If P multiple remains same, obviously the price will go up. The price will go to 166. That is next year price. That depends on whether the P multiple remains same or not. If P multiple doesn't remain same, then price may remain same and P multiple comes down to 11.12. Anything can happen in a practical world. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now, I'm going to make the same question. The question says that you're required to calculate expected market price per share at the end of year 1. I want the price at the end of year 1. Year 2, I know the price. At the end of year 2, the price is 165. At the end of year 2, the price is 165. Today, the price is 133.47. I want the price at the end of year 1. Tell me, how will you do it? Price at the end of year 1. you start doing it, rework or calculate the expected market price at the end of year one as per dividend valuation model. Market price at the end of year one as per dividend valuation model. I want the market price at the end of year one as per dividend valuation model. Whatever comes to your mind, let's discuss it. Whether it's right or wrong, we'll see. If at all, you have to do the market price at the end of year one. It's as per dividend valuation model. Which one? No, it won't be 108 alone. How will you do it? You first, let's discuss on the approach. I'm not interested in the answer. Answer, you can do it in some time. No, you cannot use it. So tell me what you want me to use. D2 by? No, growth has not stabilized. Growth has to stabilize. If the growth has stabilized, you use the formula. Growth is yet to stabilize. When I go 1 year forward, my sentence will read like that. Earnings will grow at the rate of 25% in year one. Earnings will grow at the rate of 10% in year two. Dividend payout will increase to 50%. 1 year forward, this will be the statement. So growth has not stabilized. You cannot use it. Gordon's model. So what is the formula? Or how will you do it? No, that formula won't work. That formula is not going to work because growth is 25% and 10%. I don't know why you're thinking it's exactly the same. What we are going to do is, this will become, this is no more there in scenario. I delete this because this is not there. This is year one. This is year one. 1 year gone by, and my discount rate is 1 divided by 1.15. I told you to calculate price at the end of year one. So 1 year gone by, I've removed the first year cash flow. Now after 1 year, the second year dividend is technically 1 year, first year dividend for them. Whatever you are going to get at the end of year two. We had calculated P2, no? That P2 is P1 now, after 1 year has gone by. The question's requirement is calculate the price at the end of year one, which means 1 year is already gone. This is what we have calculated as of now. Now I'll parallel calculation. This is not there anymore. That are, if it's even there, let me write it like this. This year one after a year is rupees 6. This year one after a year is 165. And you get the price, that's all. Year one after 1 year passes by is the second year dividend and second year price. Not able to understand it? No, see, I'm trying to tell you. See, the concept of finance is that present value or price of a share is the present value of future cash flows discounted at investors' required rate of return. When I started with the question, this information was there. Now, that's what you are not able to imagine this scenario. Now, the report of Swastika Consultants states as follows. Earnings and dividend will grow at 25% for the next 1 year. Earnings and dividend will grow at 25% for the next
1 year. Earnings are likely to grow at the rate of 10% from second year onwards, because the moment 1 year passes by, everything gets preceded by a year. Further, if there is a reduction in earnings growth, dividend payout will increase to 50%. The table will have 2015 also, and this will be 12 rupees, this will be 4.8. This is already gone. Everything is already gone. Ignore you have done this problem now. Ignore whatever we have done. If this question comes and I give you this information, you will say, first I'll have to calculate dividends till the growth stabilizes. Dividends till the stage growth stabilizes. When is the growth going to stabilize? Second year onwards. The growth is going to stabilize from second year onwards. So your calculation will be year DPS, sorry, EPS, DPS, year 1, year 2. I will take these figures and do it. 12. On 12, I'll put 15, 16.5. Dividend is 6, 8.25. This is my first year dividend. This is my second year dividend. Based on that, I can calculate P1. Based on that, I can calculate P1. Once I calculate that, I'll have to discount those cash flows. The basic thing is, I have told you to rework as if 1 year has already gone by. So when 1 year has passed by, look at the future cash flow and then value the share. Now, this is one way of getting the answer. The second way of getting the answer is, Modigliani Miller said P1 is equal to P0 into 1 plus KE minus the dividend which is going to be paid in that year. P0 into 1 plus KE minus the dividend which is going to be paid in that year. That is 133.47 into 1.15. This we have done under Modigliani Miller. 133.47 into 1.15 minus 4.8 of dividend. 148.70. 148.70. You can end up doing like this. Now I have this 148.70, no? This into 1.15. This into 1.15 minus 6. 1.15. P1 is equal to P0 into 1 plus KE minus dividend. P2 is equal to P1 into 1 plus KE minus dividend. The second year price will be 165. Price will be 165. You want third year price? This into 1.15 minus the dividend, 8.25. This will be the third year price. You want the fourth year price? You can get it. Fifth year price? You can get it. Sixth year price? You can get it. So Modigliani Miller builds the connect between the prices for different years. So why I want this information is, somebody will make an argument saying that I don't want to sell it at the end of first year, second year. I'll sell my share at the end of first year. Tell me what will be the price at the end of first year. The price at the end of first year is going to be 148.70. The only issue which you are facing is you are not able to think through 1 year has already gone by. So in your mind, you will have to understand that 1 year has passed by. After 1 year passing, I'll have to do the calculation. Now write these points. Point number one. The company would have paid a dividend of rupees 6. The company would have paid a dividend of rupees 6 in 2015. Rupees 6 in 2015. In bracket last year. Rupees 6 in 2015. I have already passed 1 year. I am doing this calculation. Rupees 6 in 2015 last year. Full stop. We are required to calculate the fair market price. The fair market price at the end of 2015. Fair market price at the end of 2015. Full stop. Next point. The dividends now are expected to grow at the rate of 25%
at the rate of 25% for 1 year, and post that it will grow, at the rate of 10%. Any doubts on this? Now create this. Year cash flow, PVF and DCF. Rate of return on equity. No, what rate of return?
From the company.
That is return on equity. Yeah. Okay.
P is given in question. Using P2 divided by 1 plus R, we can calculate P1.
No, 1 plus KE, not 1 plus R. So I could have done like this. 165 divided by 1.15. 165 divided by 1.15. Now on this I have to do the dividend adjustment, because dividend is an extra form of return which is given, which is plus, no, sorry, 4.8 is what would have been paid. So broadly you will get to that number. Now the basic thing is, any security which you want to value, you just need the future cash flows of that security. So when I say at the end of year one, forget first year and then see what is future cash flow available. If I say at the end of year two, forget year one and year two and see what future cash flows are available. Whenever the growth stabilizes, then only you can use Gordon's approach. You cannot end up saying that 6 divided by KE minus growth rate. That's not going to work out. I need the growth to stabilize for me to use Gordon's approach. So that I can use only at the end of year 2. Let's go to the next question. Question number 4. ABC Limited has paid a dividend of 0.40. The dividends will grow at 11.3% annually for next 3 years. Then the dividend growth will linearly decline in stage 2, year 4 to year 8. Thereafter, dividend will consistently grow at 2.3%. Calculate the value of the share if investor required rate of return is 12%. Which one? Not able to hear you.
Class. Okay, the heading as well as the questions information would have told you which model to use, which model we are going to use. Step up growth model. The growth is going to stabilize from which year? After 8 years,
So from the ninth year onward, I'll see the growth stabilizing. So I will have to technically do dividends of year 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and ninth year dividend also, because P8 is equal to D9 by KE minus G. So I need P8, which is D9 by KE minus G. You cannot value a share unless and until the growth stabilizes. Now the next point is, the growth is going to be 11.3 for first year, second year 11.3, third year 11.3. Then the dividend will linearly decline in stage 2. Thereafter, it will consistently grow at the rate of 2.3%. So year 3 is 11.3. Year 9 is 2.3. From 11.3, it will come down to 2.3. Linearly means it is going to be a consistent fall for the interim period. From 11.3, it falls down to 2.3 in how many years? Read it carefully. 5 years or 6 years? So in between I'll have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I'll have to keep reducing it by some number so that I finally get 2.3. I'll have to reduce by some number. What number should I reduce it by? Okay, if I do 1.8, this will become 11.3 minus 1.8 is 9.5 minus 1.8 is 7.7, 5.9, 4.1, 2.3, 0.5. If I keep reducing by 1.8, it becomes 2.3 in the 8th year itself. But I have to make 2.3 in which year? Year 9. So it's going to be divided by 6. It may look like it is 5 years, but it is 6 years. So you have to divide by 1. So 11.3 minus 1.5, 9.8, 8.3, 6.8, 5.3, 3.8, and then the growth becomes 2.3. So the growth will start at 11.3% for year 1, year 2, year 3. From 11.3, the fall till 2.3 is in 6 years, it is not in 5 years. Clear? Any doubts in this? That's the only thing which is there. I don't have anything else to do. You will end up doing the calculation and getting to the market price. It's more of calculation beyond that. Any doubts in this? Now, right? Dividends are expected to grow at the rate of at the rate of 11.3% for the first 3 years. The growth will consistently fall, and it will become 2.3%, in year 9. Next point. There's a reduction of 9% in growth over a period of 6 years. And hence the annual fall is 1.5%. Next point. Dividend growth will stabilize.
dividend growth will stabilize from year 9, will stabilize from year 9, from year 9, and hence P8 will stabilize from year 9, and hence P8 can be computed as per Gordon's formula. I need the growth to stabilize. Whenever you feel growth has stabilized, Gordon's come into picture. Clear? Next, calculation of dividends till year 9. You can do it three columns: year, growth rate, and dividend. Year, growth rate, and dividend. Year, growth rate, and dividend. Growth rate and dividend. Do the calculation. Let the dividends be 4 decimal answer. Let it be a 4 decimal number. In the calculator, you will do it like this: 0.4 into 1.13, sorry, yeah, 1.113, 11.3% or plus 11.30%. That number again plus 11.30%. That number plus 11.30%, plus 9.80%, plus 8.3%. You will keep doing this in the calculator. 0.40 plus 11.30%. Again plus 11.30%. This may work in few calculators. If it's not working, then into 1.113. 11.3 is 113. Into 1.113. Into 1.113. Into 1.113. Into 1.098. 1.083 goes on like that. The only adjustment which is there in this question is understanding the growth rate. You don't have anything beyond that. Any doubts on this? Any doubts on dividend calculation? Clear? Then below that P8 is equal to P8 is equal to D9 divided by KE minus G. P8 is equal to D9 by KE minus G. D9 divided by KE minus G. The moment growth stabilizes, you can use Gordon's formula. P8 is equal to D9 divided by KE minus G. What is the cost of equity? How much? 12%. And stabilized growth is? 2.3%. P8 is equal to D9 divided by KE minus G. Price at the end of year 8 is equal to 9th year dividend divided by cost of equity minus growth rate. Any doubts on this? Now how will we value the share? I want your participation. Unless you are participating, I am not moving forward. How should we value the share now?
Valuation of share, yeah. Find out? Yeah, year cash flow, PBF. DCF. Please participate. It's already done. I'm not doing anything new. If at all there's a new adjustment, I'll explain in detail. I would want you to participate and do it together. So do year cash flow PVF DCF. Year cash flow PVF DCF. How many year cash flows are to be written?
8 years.
Because at the end of 8th year, I've got the price. The moment I get the price, I stop the cash flow at that year. So year 1 to 8 will have dividends, and in year 8 you will add the market price also. In year 8 you will add the market price, or you do it as a separate line item as market price, whatever way you want to do it.
Year cash flow PVF DCF.
You keep doing it, don't copy it from the board. I've added dividend as the market price. 0.7655 plus, are you rated as two separate line items? Check the number. 6. You will get this one. The closer answer. Then can you proceed? Okay. Let's move to question number 5. On the basis of the following information, current dividend, discount rate, growth rate, calculate the present value of stock of ABC Limited. Is its stock overvalued if stock price is 35, ROE 9%, EPS 2.25? Those two are separate questions as such. It's an exam problem only, but when I solve it, I'll have to solve it separately. If I link it, I'll not get an answer. First, let's analyze those first 4 lines of the question. Which model can we use there? Gordon's model. They have given current dividend D0, which makes it very clearer to us. Discount rate, I have KE. I have growth rate. All the information which I need to do the problem, I have. I cannot do Walters, because for Walters, we need R, we need earnings. All of that is not there. So part 1 is through Gordon. So let's do it through Gordon. P naught equal to D1 by KE minus growth rate. P naught equal to D1 by KE minus growth rate.
T1 will be 2.5 into what is the growth rate? So into 1.02. Cost of equity is 10.5% minus 2%. So the price is 30 rupees. 2.5 into 1.02 divided by 8.5%. Any doubts on that? Now the second part is a little tricky, so because in an exam scenario this is very difficult to understand. Is the stock overvalued if stock price is 35, ROE 9%, EPS 2.25? My EPS can't be 2.25 when my dividend is 2.5. Logically, EPS can't be 2.25 when dividend is 2.5. So I'm not going to link both parts to the question. So that's a separate problem. This is a separate problem altogether, because if I end up linking it, I again have a confusion. Now ROE is 9%, EPS is 2.25. This is the only two information we have. We don't have anything else. They have given current market price is 35. I have to get the fair market price. If the fair market price is more than 35, stock is undervalued. If the fair market price is less than 35, stock is overvalued. Only two information: EPS, ROE. EPS is 2.25. ROE is 9%. Now with this two, how can we get an answer? EPS would be, that is growth. Growth is IRR into retention. No, EPS by ROE is not dividend. Only two information, don't look at the earlier information. Yeah. EPS into will give you what? It's not EPS into ROE, going in the right direction, but it's not EPS into ROE. Problem number one today we did. Now what is the formula for EPS there? First problem which we did. First problem, EPS is equal to book value into ROE. So fair value is equal to EPS divided by ROE. EPS divided by ROE. Rather than multiplying it, I will divide it. Wait for some time. This is one approach. The second approach is my P multiple can be taken as inverse of ROE or KE. You can take it as inverse of ROE or KE. Both will give you the same answer. Now wait for some time. Fair value. Today morning we had done EPS is equal to book value into ROE. So I'm going to use the same formula. 2.25 is equal to book value. Technically I call it as fair value. Fair value into 9%. Fair value is equal to 2.25 divided by 9%. 2.25 divided by 9%, which is 25. This is one approach. The second approach is P multiple is equal to 1 divided by ROE. 1 divided by ROE, RKE, and fair prices. Again same 25. Now please listen, it's not that I've given two different formula, both the formulas are same only. It's not two different formula. Fair value is equal to EPS divided by ROE or EPS into P multiple. P multiple is nothing but 1 by ROE. Same, EPS by ROE or EPS by ROE. It's the same formula, it's not two different formula. EPS divided by ROE can give you the fair price of the share, or EPS into 1 by ROE, which is technically called as P multiple. 1 by ROE is technically P multiple. Clear? Any doubts on this? There are a lot of ambiguities in the question, but this is the only way I can do this problem, which is I'm considering, this is with an assumption that my book value will be equal to the fair value, with an assumption, because your ROE and EPS linkage is on the book value, not on the market value. When we did problem number one, it had book value in the question. We did
EPS is equal to book value into ROE. I did not take the market value into ROE. So for the given information, this is the only possible answer, which is EPS divided by ROE or EPS into PE multiple, which is 1 divided by ROE. Next, come down, part 2. Point number 1, ROE is given in the question. ROE is given in the question. ROE is given in the question,
and the inverse of ROE, and the inverse of ROE, inverse of ROE can be taken as P multiple. Inverse of ROE can be taken as P multiple. How is the inverse of ROE P multiple is? The logic is here. So I have EPS P multiple and I get the market price of a share. Now my assumption is market price and book value is same. That's the assumption with which I work. So when my market price and book value are same, book value into ROE, book value into ROE is equal to EPS. Book value into ROE is equal to EPS. Now this formula which I am talking about here, fair value is equal to EPS by ROE. In place of 1 by ROE, I can use P multiple. 1 by ROE, EPS divided by ROE, in place of 1 divided by ROE, you can use P multiple. EPS into P multiple. In short, I'll just take it to that. Just a minute. When we were doing Walter's model, the cost of equity at times is expressed as the inverse of P ratio. If you go ahead and make an assumption saying that book value and market value is same, indirect assumption is ROE and KE is same. That's an implicit assumption. Whenever you say book value and market value is same, your implicit assumption, hidden assumption is ROE and KE is same. So when I can say P multiple is the inverse of ROE or the inverse of KE, so that is why this formula is coming. It's more because of this line. The cost of equity at times is expressed as the inverse of P ratio. So K is equal to 1 by P multiple, ROE is equal to 1 by P multiple is equal to 1 by ROE. So what have you written now? And the inverse, okay, then write P multiple equal to 1 by ROE. P multiple equal to 1 by ROE. P multiple equal to 1 by ROE. How much it is? Eleven point one one percent. Sorry, 11.11 times. It's in times. 11.11 times. 11.11 times. Then price equal to EPS into P multiple. Price equal to EPS into P multiple, which is 2.25 into 11.11. You will get the answer as 25. Is the stock overvalued? Is the stock overvalued if the stock price is 35? Yes, the stock is overvalued because the fair price is only 25. So, right, the stock is overvalued. The stock is overvalued. Is overvalued as the fair market price is
as the fair market price is 25, whereas the CMP, current market price, is 35. Clear? Any doubts on this? The only issue with this question is I don't have a linkage between part 1 and part 2. So in an exam scenario, it's very difficult to think through that way. Institute has been doing this. They kind of, this is an incomplete question. As such, it's an incomplete question. Some issues are there. So whatever it is, you'll have to work with whatever information the material gives. Now let's go to question number 6. A company has an EPS of 10 and the opportunity cost of capital for its equity shareholder is 16%. If the share is now trading at 80, calculate the present value of growth opportunity. Okay, now I'll first explain what is present value of growth opportunity. I have introduced newer terms earlier, so we have written all of that in summary of adjustment, like limiting value. Now similar one name is present value of growth opportunity. Now what is present value of growth opportunity? See, that is price with growth minus price with zero growth. If you have zero growth, the price will be lower, and when there is a growth available in the company, the price is going to be higher. The question is given, share is now trading at what? 80 rupees. That 80 could be because there is a growth potential in the company. That 80 could be because there is a growth potential in the company. I will have to calculate if the price, if the growth is 0. If the growth is 0 and that price is assumed 45. That price is 45, then the present value of growth opportunity is 35. Because you are growing, the price is 35 rupees more than the price which you will get if there is a zero growth. If there is a zero growth. So present value of growth opportunity is nothing but basically the difference between the current market price given in the question minus the price which will exist if there is a zero growth. Minus the price which will exist if there is a zero growth. That we'll have to do the calculation. So I'll come to that part in some time now, right? First, present value of growth opportunity, PVGO. Present value of growth opportunity, PVGO. Present value of growth opportunity. Alright, PVGO is the difference between current market price and the fair market price of a company with zero growth. Fair market price of a company with zero growth. Current market price and the fair market price of a company with zero growth. Now I will have to calculate the share price as if there is a zero growth. I have information on EPS. What do you mean by opportunity cost of capital? KE. So we have EPS. We have KE. If I have to do Walter's model, I need D, I need KE, R,
KE and E minus D, earnings is available. If there is a zero growth, if there is a zero growth, what will be the payout ratio? 100%. So earnings, dividend, both are same. But Walter still can't be used because I don't have R. For Walter's approach, I need R. So we are going to use Gordon's approach. D1 by KE minus G. D1 is 10 rupees. D1 is 10 rupees because zero growth. The assumption is zero growth. At a zero growth level, the EPS and DPS is same. We don't have any confusion of D0, D1 and all because everything is going to remain same 10. So 10, cost of equity is 16%. Growth is 0%. Growth is 0%. Next point. A company will have a 0% growth. A company will have a 0% growth. A company will have a 0% growth with payout ratio of 100%. Will have 0% growth with payout ratio of 100%. With payout ratio of 100%. Full stop. Hence, DPS and EPS will remain same. DPS and EPS, DPS and EPS will remain same. Next point. FMP will be calculated. FMP will be calculated under Gordon's model. FMP will be calculated under Gordon's model. Clear? Next, FMP with 0% growth equal to FMP with 0% growth equal to FMP with 0% growth equal to with 0% growth equal to D1 by KE minus G. G will be 0%. D1 by KE minus G, 10 divided by 16%. How much you get? 62.5. But the market is giving a price of 80 rupees. That is because they see some growth potential in the company. When you see growth potential, the price can be higher. So you can now calculate PVGO. You know the formula for PVGO. Any doubts on 62.5? Get the PVGO. 80 minus 62.5. 80 minus 62.5. Extra 17.5 is paid for the growth potential of the company. That's called as present value of growth opportunity. Any doubts on this? Clear? Can we proceed? Any doubts on this question? So, most of the questions you have seen till now, we have used only Gordon's model. That's what will be predominantly used. That step up growth model which you see is not a different model. That's also Gordon's only. That is also given by Gordon only. He said that the growth can be different for multiple years. If it's different, you do year cash flow, PVF, DCF rather than using the formula straight away. Formula straight away application can't be done. So you use year cash flow, PVF, DCF. So that is what is predominantly used in most of the question. And in case a problem which we do, we don't know which model to use. But I can get a structure called as year cash flow, PVF and DCF. If you can get that structure, then you solve the problem in that way. For example, if I have to value this building, I'll write year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. Year 1, rent of 4 lakhs. Year 2, rent of 6 lakhs. Year 3, rent of 8 lakhs. Year 4, rent of 10 lakhs. At the end of year 5, I'll sell this for 1 crore 50 lakhs. That's the value. I have written all of this.
I will discount it at 10% if I want a return of 10%. I'll discount it at 12% if I want a return of 12%. Any asset you can value with this: year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. This PVF at the rate will depend on what you want. Somebody will say 10%, somebody will say 8%, somebody will say 17%, 15%. Year and cash flow, you will have to make your estimation. It can go wrong. It's not that it has to exactly. I wanted to sell the property after 4 years for 1.5 crores. Demonetization happened, prices have come down. So anything can happen. So that is beyond your control. But you do an estimate and then accordingly you value any asset class. So anything to be valued, you need only these three: year, cash flow, PVF and DCF. So if in any problem we can do this, we'll end up using it that approach. Otherwise your Walters, Gordons, anyone will come into picture. Now question 7. In the past year, ABC paid a dividend of 1.4. An analyst expects dividend to grow annually at 9.3% for next 4 years. At the end of year 4, analyst expects the dividend to equal 40% of EPS and the P multiple to be 11. If the required return on ABC Limited stock is 11.5%, calculate the current market price. Okay, now coming to this question, I know the dividend for last year is 1.4%. After that, it will grow at the rate of 9.3% for a period of 4 years. After 4 years, what is going to happen is not given in the question. I don't know what is going to happen after 4 years. Will the growth stabilize or it's a continuing growth of 9.3%? Nothing is given in the question. But they are saying at the end of year 4, analyst expects the dividend to equal 40% of EPS and P multiple to be 11. Now with this information, I can calculate price at the end of year 4. I can calculate price at the end of year 4. Price at the end of year 4 is EPS into P multiple. EPS into P multiple. Now why they have given this information is, they are indirectly telling you, you use year cash flow, PVF, DCF itself. What we used to normally do is, this would have become a step-up growth like this. The growth will be at 9.3% for the first 4 years. After that, it will stabilize at the rate of 5%. When stabilizes, what we have been doing is, 1, 2, 3, 4, you will write the dividends and you will say P4 is equal to D5 by KE minus G. In this case, same thing, but they are saying P4 is equal to EPS of year 4 into P multiple. Rather than D5 by KE minus G, you use P4 as EPS of year 4 into P multiple. They have just made the question a little different. Instead of making it as D5 by KE minus G, the formula has been given which says EPS of year 4 into P multiple. Once I get that, year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. Year 1 dividend, year 2 dividend, year 3 dividend, year 4 dividend, and year 4 again market price. Year 4 is market price. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now, what is this 11.5%? Required return means KE, return means ROE. So, if the required return on equity is 11.5%, that's technically your cost of equity. Technically your cost of equity. What do a shareholder expect? Or what do an investor expect? Clear? Any doubts on this? Now, write point number one. The dividends are expected to grow. The dividends are expected to grow. Are expected to grow at a constant rate of. Grow at a constant rate of 9.3%. Constant rate of 9.3%. full stop. Price, next point, price at the end of year 4. Price at the end of year 4. Price at the end of year 4 can be calculated. Can be calculated with the help of P multiple. Price at the end of year 4 can be calculated with the help of P multiple. Any doubts on this? Now, year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. We'll first calculate dividends for 4 years and then we'll see what is to be done for price. Calculate dividends for 4 years. Two decimals would do. Dividends for 4 years. Two decimal answer. +9.3% for year 1, year 2, year 3 and year 4. Two decimal answer, that should do. Can you proceed? Any doubts on this? Now leave some three lines. Leave some three lines below the table. Come down. Price at the end of year 4. P4 equal to. The only difference I am doing is normally you are used to the practice of writing it as D5 by KE minus G. In this case it is EPS of year 4 into P multiple. That's the only difference in this question. EPS of year 4 into P multiple. P4 equal to EPS of year 4 into P multiple. What is the dividend ratio? They have said some payout are written. 40% of? Your dividends is 40% of EPS. Any doubts till now? EPS of year 4 equal to? EPS of year 4 equal to dividend of year 4 divided by 40%. Dividend of year 4 divided by 40%. Dividend of year 4 divided by 40%. Any doubts on this? Your dividend is equal to 40% of EPS. EPS is equal to dividend by 40%. What will be the price then at the end of year 4? How much is the P multiple? 11. Now I don't see any difference in this problem and the earlier problems. The only calculation difference is P4 used to be calculated as D5 by KE minus G. Here you need not do it that way, you do it through EPS approach. Your price is 55. Anybody has any doubts on the price of 55? EPS into P multiple. 5 rupees into 11. 5 into 11, 55. PVF is at what rate? 11.5. In the calculator, 1 divided by 1.115, first year factor equal to second year, third year, it will go on like that. 1 divided by, I'm not explained on the factors and all, I assume whatever you would have done at IPCC level, it continues the same way. Any doubts in this? Your price was 55 at the end of year 4. Can you proceed? Done? Any doubts? Can you proceed to the next part? Okay, let's move to question number 8. X Limited just declared a dividend of 14 per share. Mr. B is planning to purchase the share of X Limited, anticipating increase in growth rate from 8% to 9%, which will continue for 3 years. He also expects the market price of the share to be 360. You are required to determine maximum amount Mr. B should pay for share if he requires a rate of return of 13%. Maximum price Mr. B will be willing to pay for share if he is of the opinion that 9% growth can be maintained indefinitely and require 13% rate of return. Price of share at the end of 3 years if 9% growth rate is achieved and assuming other conditions remaining same as in part 2 above. Please go through the question. Okay, now coming to this question, friends, coming to this question, company has just declared a dividend of 14 per share, technically D0. I have the growth rate in the question. Growth is going to come from 8 to 9. So the growth is going to increase to 9%. He says the price is going to be 360 after 3 years. What is the maximum amount Mr. B should pay for shares? Maximum amount is today's price, P0. If he requires a rate of return of 13%, what do you mean by requires a rate of return? KE. So I have KE, I have dividend, I have growth, but the only problem is growth is for 3 years. I don't know what is going to happen after 3 years. Similar to the previous problem, the growth was given for 4 years. But the best thing here is, last problem gave a P multiple. Here they have said price at the end of year 3 is going to be 360. They have also given you the price. You need not do any calculation. P year 1 dividend, year 2 dividend, year 3 dividend, year 3 price is 360. So we have seen 3 types of problems now. In one problem we used to do P3S D4 by KE minus G. The second type of problem which we have done, where it was EPS into P multiple. Now the third type of a problem where the value itself is given in the question, I need not even calculate it. Again, year cash flow PVF DCF, year 1 dividend, year 2 dividend, year 3 dividend, year 3 price. Part 2, part 3 will do it in some time. Let's first do part 1. Calculation of maximum price. Calculation of maximum price. Year cash flow PVF at %13 and DCF. Year cash flow PVF at %13 DCF. You know what is to be done. Everything is more or less readily available. 2 decimal answer. Year 1 14 into 1.09, again into 1.09. Price at the end of year 3 need not be calculated, it's given in the question. What is it saying? 360. This is that person's expectation. The price will be 360. This is similar to that property part I was saying. Year 1 so much rent, year 2 so much rent, year 3 so much rent. At the end of year 3, I'll sell the property for 360 rupees. Year 1 rental income, year 2 rental income, year 3 rental income. And at the end of year 3, we sell it for 360. You can have some rounding off differences, let's not worry about that, whatever number you get. Now, can we go to part 2? Let's go to part 2. Maximum price Mr. B will be willing to pay for share if he is of the opinion that 9% growth can be maintained indefinitely and require 13% rate of return per annum. Now, he is saying 9% is a perpetual growth. How will you get an answer to this? P naught is equal to D1 by KE minus G. So, calculate. P naught equal to D1 by KE minus G. Consistent 9% growth. P naught is equal to D1 by KE minus G. D1 by KE minus G. If consistent growth is going to be there, the price is 381.5. P naught is equal to D1 by KE minus G. Gordon can be used only when you have a visibility of growth with no end to it. There should not be end. Even if it's 90 years and there is an end, you cannot use directly the formula. You have to go only through a cash flow approach. It's a perpetual growth. So, a problem if it talks about 5 years and then say growth will continue, then it's fine. If the growth is not going to be there, I cannot straight away use the Gordon's formula. Then the next part says, price at the end of 3 years, if 9% growth rate is achieved and assuming other conditions remaining same as in part 2 above. Part 2 talks about what? Perpetual growth. Part 2 talks about perpetual growth. Price at the end of 3rd year is P3 is equal to D4 by KE minus G. Price at the end of 3rd year is P3 equal to D4 by KE minus G. You find out the D4, divide by KE minus G. P3 is equal to D4 by KE minus G. Consistent growth. D4 by KE minus G. D4, which is 18.13, add 9% to it, divided by KE minus G, which is 4%. Yeah, 494 point something. Differences will be there because of rounding off. You get whatever number, it's fine. 494 point something. Price at the end of 3rd year, P3 is equal to D4 by KE minus G. See, the only rule is Gordon has to be used when you see stabilization in growth happening. So, if every year it's the same growth, I can even calculate P80. P80 is equal to D81 by KE minus G. P10 is equal to D11 by KE minus G. Any year we need, we can get it. P5 is equal to D6 by KE minus G. Clear? Any doubts on this? We'll take a break of 30 minutes and then we continue. Today class will go on till 2 o'clock.